This is Sky recording live. We had some technical difficulties last time. Twitch kept stopping its broadcast for I don't know what reason, and then QuickTime crashed during recording, so ended up with nothing. So technical things happen, but the good news is that over the weekend I did some coding and some thinking about the design of the game engine, and really settled on where the direction I want to head, and kind of cheated on you guys a little bit. I actually coded out how I want to see it, so I'm still going to go over it. I'm actually going to code it straight here on Twitch, but I actually have it on a branch, so you'll see me referencing it, because I got it exactly where I would like it to be, and so I just want to check it out as a back out, just because I just want to make sure I've got what I wanted, which I do. So let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so trying to figure out what I talked about last time and didn't talk about last time. The one thing I wanted to add to this is I found this over the weekend, is I have a test here that verifies the instance. This is kind of causes a problem. I guess the core of this, I wanted to test against JavaScript just in case I wanted to I wanted to build this for HTML5 someday. And so I ran the tests on here and they fail, and I wanted to know why. And I'll run this for you real quick. There's actually a handful of failures. One's easy to solve. So hexlib run in unit. Test. And this will build out. There shouldn't be any changes here. But you'll see that we get three errors and one fail. So the first error happens to do with the differences between the language targets, is that this array comes in as a null. And on C++, it seems to kind of handle that better. So all we need to do is we say constructor args, if it's null, constructor args equals empty array. And so that'll make it pass. That's not necessarily the fastest approach, and we'll address that sometime in the future if it becomes a problem, but we shouldn't be creating objects that frequently to where it's a performance problem. And so So now we have this one failure, which is actually should create the object from the injector. And there seems to be a problem with the JavaScript target with Mockitoo. We can't actually verify this. And I'm actually going to take it out. I'm not necessarily going to get any less value out of doing an assertion that the retval is and the sample are the same. So what's going on here is I'm creating this sample, and on the get instance I'm returning retval anyways, and then they should be the same instance at this point. So this still validates that. So I'm going to run this, and we should get passing on JavaScript and we do. So just wanted to sort of clear that up. I wanted to get JavaScript working. I don't want it to run every time. Kind of one of my goals of this project is I want to run this on desktop and consoles. And so JavaScript isn't really that important of a target to me personally. You guys might want to, maybe you don't think the same. You may not agree with that. So just for fun, I'm just going to run Flash 9 to see 9 plus, to see if that passes as well. And it does. Okay, so I'll occasionally go back and run through and make sure some of the stuff passes for Flash and JavaScript, just for historic reasons or just for compatibility reasons that I'm writing cross-platform hacks, and that's important to me. Even though we're making like a game engine, some of these pieces should be reused for anything. It doesn't have to be a game. So I want to make sure that stuff works on all targets. Just to just to keep things compatible. Like, I want to make sure the code is running the way we expect it. So C++ never changes, and that's a good thing. That was our original target. So what I'm gonna do is we've got some of our core rendering stuff kind of happening together. I've created this graphics interface, and I wanted to get rid of it, so I'm going to. I didn't like this. I'd rather use dependency injection. So we're just gonna get rid of that. I'm gonna try and move a little bit quicker because I just have a lot to cover, and I didn't get the earliest start. So we've got some stuff going on here. We got the two-dimensional display node. We got display node. So I'm actually going to create two more interfaces. One's going to be a bitmap node. This is for our actual bitmap display stuff. And we're going to create a image data. And I'm going to make this dynamic. And so what this means is that cross-target is image data can be interpreted in different ways, and I wanted to make this dynamic so that we can use all kinds of different rendering engines and rendering pipelines in the future. So I'm going to add a few more things here. I'm going to say I'm going to have the SX, which is the X location of the image. It's going to be a getter and setter. It's essentially what we did for our main here. Oop, not that main. A live game here. Essentially, all these arguments here, just going to have those in our interface. So this is SX, SY, H, WH. Okay, so that's that. And make sure our bitmap node extends. Display node. There we go. And then I'm going to create one more interface. This is going to be a text field node so that we can have text. This is also going to extend the display node. And so I'm going to create a text. Task text, a getter and setter, that's going to be a string. We're going to have a font size, that's going to be a getter and setter. We're going to have a font color, it's going to be a getter and setter. And it's going to be uint, and actually, this is wrong, it's going to be uint as well. And then lastly, we're going to have a font name. Notice we're not using a font. That's also another platform-specific thing, and we can handle that specifically and still make it fast. One thing I wanted to call out is I had someone ask me, why am I building another game engine? Why not use existing engines like Lime or Heaps or... You know, why am I using Ka specifically? To answer that question, actually, is I'm not actually using only Ka. Yes, we're using Ka, but I'm building this so abstract that we should be able to use OpenFL, we should be able to use Heaps, we should be able to use rendering engine number 9. Whatever we decide, whatever comes popular, we shouldn't need to change our overlying framework to run with these rendering engines and sound engines, things like that. Another reason too is I wanted to have it documented, video documented, so that people can actually go through and see the inner workings of how the engine works. A lot of people, like, you know, try and read, you know, just regular documentation. It's hard to parse. You don't get to understand the deep guts of how the engine works. This, you can actually just go through, watch the videos, understand how the pieces work, and understand it. And lastly, two more things. This game engine is going to be fully TDD, as close as I can get it. So you can always go through and know that everything is super solid underneath. And if there's any bugs, I don't break things by fixing bugs. My design is clear. And so you can work on a more solid foundation than a project that is written without unit tests. And I'll prove that to you. It's always worked. Never fails. And finally, I want to show you my dedication to dependency injection. So the goal of this is at the end of the creation of this game is you can take this and you can actually just override the different pieces that I've already built for you. Maybe you don't want to build a particular, like this exact game. Well, you can just override my pieces and change it to any way you want it. And that's the beauty of the way this game engine works. So continuing here, so I did notice that with the display node, I have all these as defaults. I actually want to change these to getters and setters so I can override them. I thought I could, but I was wrong. So I'm gonna set these to getters and setters. And then our two-dimensional display node, we need to reflect that here. And then we just need to generate all these real quick. Getters and setter. And so there's our getters and setters. And we're going to set function get. That'll work. I'll change that one to public get. Public function get. Constant. And so that should change all those. And set the explicit on this. And just enforce that we're returning what we expect. So I hope you understand my rationale for building another engine. I hope that's something you agree with, or I mean, if you don't agree with it, then don't. Like, tell me why. Like, tell me why that's still a bad idea. You know, the thing I could argue against it is, you know, maybe I could use all this effort and write unit tests. But I can't guarantee I can write unit tests for someone else's engine. It has to be designed in a certain way so that you can test it. You can spend forever mocking it. And I don't know for sure if you can, I don't know for sure if all these engines we can just override things if we want. So I think this is going to be somewhat special in its own way. Okay. So there we go. Here's our two-dimensional split display node. We have created a cost sprite that extends the two-dimensional display node container. I'm going to override the getter of x and the getter of y for now. We'll come back to this later. But I'm just going to stub this in because I know where I'm going now with this. So I'm going to return super.x. I'll just do it this. And this. And you know what? I'm going to come back and do this when we actually want to do this. Okay, there we go. So, one thing I want to do, actually, I made those changes, I just want to make sure I'm in the tests. So, there we go. Two dimensional display node. There is an unexpected public at 132. Private public. Make sure I test till pass. There you do. So I did run into an issue I didn't get to check on. Is looked like I was having trouble testing against Ka. And so I want to make sure that we if we can't test against it, we need to make something happen differently. So I'm going to create a cod directory here. So this is just our cost specific stuff. Next, we're going to do a cod text node. And that's going to extend a two-dimensional display node, and it's going to implement a text field node. There's all that, and it's kind of a bummer it doesn't actually generate getter and setter. So I'm not going to test these guys for now, because I'm just validating that the get and set works. Which I find kind of excessive. But we will end up making changes to this, and they will have unit tests. There we go. So everything's in place except for this one, so text. Okay, why is that? That's over here. Oh, those are implemented, so okay. So we got those there. And one more thing, we're going to create a bitmap node. And this one's going to extend a two-dimensional display node, and it's going to implement a bitmap node. And we need to get these generated. So just in case we can't actually test these guys, I don't know if there's any sort of macro magic happening with the Cobb build. But I remember I was having issues with it. But these are pretty basic, simple things happening here, so I feel sort of safe about it. There we go. Int. And there we have it. Now, one new thing, we're going to have the ka renderer. And so this is actually what's going to be rendering our display. And this is going to implement a renderer. And this is the part that I was still trying to design out last time we were casting and kind of flesh it out. So one thing we're going to do is we're going to inject the graphics. And this is the ka graphics to graphics. And this is where we'll need some unit testing. So we're going to create a taxlib, run inunit, create display to ka renderer test. Class name should must start with FFS letter. And anyways. Pretty sure it is. Oh, that's hacks. Hacks lib. There we go. And here's our test. We're gonna use our macro here, which is Mockitu. We're going to ditch this test for now. And we're going to do public, what is it, public, private var car renderer. Car renderer. and have it var graphics. That's going to be the car graphics to the graphics. And this one we could probably just import. Okay. Now we're going to run a quick test. Should inject graphics, and we'll probably get rid of this. I want to make sure this mocking is going to work with graphics. Graphics equals mock graphics. And then car renderer equals new car renderer. Car renderer equals null. Graphics equals null. It's probably excessive right now, but so car renderer. Car renderer graphics. Graphics. One thing we missed here is we want this to extend that base object. I'm going to make sure that so now, get that in there. Car renderer init. Assert are equal the car renderer init graphics car renderer. And let's see. Yes. Okay, it's not finding this. And this is the issue I ran into. And I don't know what sort of things the car make is doing, but I can't seem to. Yeah, so it's just car. Can't seem to test it. We can try a class path to car. Yes, car sources. Yeah. And see if that does anything. Can't mark inline method. No inline. So yeah, it's doing some sort of magic. So kind of at a loss for that. So for now, we're going to have to ignore this, which is really unfortunate. Just don't like it. I wonder if I could just do dynamic. Maybe. Maybe. There's no fear of necessarily constructing it. no field for it. Yeah, so it's just upset with this. If I go with dynamic. It will build, it will test, it will pass. I don't like it. I don't want to run against dynamic on this one, just because it's very specific to cost. So let's set it back to graphics. Let me think about that for a bit. This will exist, but comment it out. What's this? This is the minimum in here. I don't need the constructor. Let me think about this a bit, whether or not to use dynamic. I don't want to. Let me stick with this for now. Okay, so this is where the render magic is going to happen. And this is where I'm going to reference my what I did over the weekend, which is under display, resources, display to car renderer. Against my display branch. Let's hit that button. Nope. Okay, I'll rename it. So it's essentially going to be this. Live game, it's going to be mostly this. Like that. No, it's not mostly going to be that. Alright. Let's check out. Some good stuff going on here. Okay. Where's my... Ooh. My spell's not working? That's a bummer. Let's see here. What we could do, let's just do that. Okay, we have status. Edge. We did quite a bit of stuff here. Let's get status, get add tests. Get add test status. Added display node interfaces and started. I want to make sure I get the way I want it. Catch display. Yeah. No, don't want to go away. Display. Sources display to car renderer. 2D renderer. That's expensive. Yeah, there's more, way more going on here. So what we're gonna do is we're going to we're just gonna cut this. I want to make sure I get this the way I want it, but also build it and explain it. So do render. Okay, master. So we're gonna go to our render In fact, I might just rename it to the 2D renderer. Like I should. We're going to have a container, and this is going to be a cosprite. We're going to inject that. This container. So here is where we're actually going to do all of our rendering. So how this is going to work, it's going to work recursively. So, because if we look back at our interface, we have a, on our layer manager, we have a renderer. So what's going to happen is we're going to iterate through every single one of the layers and call render. So it's not just going to be a single instance, it's going to have multiple render calls on this particular render function based on the layer. So the layer manager is going to call a bunch of layer rendering. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a private function, which is render, either render children. Oops, children. Called rend. And we're going to pass it the container, the x position, and the y position. This is why I really wish I could test this. Ooh, I just thought of something that might work. Okay, let me still think about that. And so whenever we call this, we need to be able to offset the containers above it. When we render children, this is going to be a container. This is going to be the container X and the container Y. Make sure it's going good. All right. Why are you? Oh, it can't tell you. All right. And now we're going to say if the we're going to go through the children. So for child and container children, if standard library is a cosprite, we're going to call render children again. We're going to pass the child, and we're going to pass the child's x plus the x position, child y plus the y position. So we're going to, whenever we have a u, stop it. So we'll have a container, like so. And so if we add another one inside of it, we want to offset the x and the y. So if we put the container, it'd actually be off to the side. Oops, looking like this. So we'd know where we were, and we can put things inside there. So we want to add the x and the y. And we're going to see a little bit more clearly how this is going to happen. That's probably the most cryptic documentation ever, so I'm going to get rid of it. Else, if standard is a Cobb bitmap node, I'm going to do else for now on that one. So we're going to cast it to a bitmap, Cobb bitmap node. cast child to pod bitmap node. This one here, the next one is going to be our, this one here is going to be our text field. Text node. In fact, I'm going to rename this to cloud text field node. Lots to cover today. Oops, what is that there? Text field. And then here, we're going to do our what we're doing in our live game, which is our draw set image. Just this one line. That's all we need. So we go back to our renderer. We're going to use our graphics. And our image is going to be our bitmap image data. Use this stick with bitmap X. Oh. Bitmap Y. Bitmap SX. Bitmap SY. I'm just giving you a line. Bitmap SW. Bitmap SH. There we go. And then here, we're going to do our text fields, which is going to be similar to our, we don't have that anymore, but it's just going to be writing our text data out. So it's like graphics, our font size is going to be text field font size. Why isn't that nothing up? Oh. Text field font size, graphics, color, which is going to be text field, color, from value, text field, color, not color. And one thing we need to do is that this actually sets it for an entire buffer, so we need to set our color back to white, and so that we don't lose that. And I'll show you that later. Maybe I'll just do that for now. You'll see that, but that'll cause if we don't set that back to white. And we have our font. Our last thing is our font, which we're going to set to null for now, just so that we stub it in. And we're going to fix that too. And graphics. Is it set string? Draw string? Draw string. That's going to be our text field. Text. And that's going to be our text field X, text field Y. Done. Okay. I'm going to do a quick sanity check. And that's what we want. Okay. Now, one thing we're going to add is we don't have our fonts. What I want to do is I want to create a map. Public static. Our fonts, and this is going to be our font map. So this is going to be map string font, and this is specific to cost. So we're okay with this. And that's going to be set through our dependency injection. There we go. So we're going to say font. We're going to say fonts get text field. Font name. So now we've got our class-specific font that we need and our abstract name that we'll use here. Okay. And we'll probably end up caching some of this later as we get more into performance important things, but we're just iteratively working forward. Okay, so that's in place. We don't want to also prematurely optimize. That's also a thing. So if our renderable layer manager, we need to, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to implement, I'll come back to that. Okay, so there's our object factory. We've got lots of things working together right now. So now I'm going to create a new class, is where we store all of our settings, dependency software settings for our game. It's actually going to be called our injection settings. And so we're kind of getting lower on time. I'm going to make sure that we I'm going to commit here, added the cog to the renderer. So we got a checkpoint there, committing often. So what we're going to do is we're going to need a couple of dependencies in here that we need to drop in, and we need to clean up our live game a bit. So we don't need this anymore. We're past this. We're way past these days. So we're going to get rid of that. I'm going to keep the initialized. I don't need this. I'm going to keep our back buffer. I don't need that. I don't need that. I don't need this. I'm going to keep this for now. This will be all cleaned up. So we definitely don't need all this stuff down here anymore. That'll be for our animation system. We're going to abstract this out later. And here we have it. So one thing I did test is the frame buffer gets passed in. In fact, I'll just prove it real quick. The frame buffer gets passed in, and I'm gonna make sure our build happens real quick. Hexlib run in unit test. Our tests are still running. Let's see if this still builds. Okay, that still builds. Okay, so. Okay, we don't need this wizard anymore. The frame buffer is the same frame buffer every time. So let me show you. So we check loaded. If we do trace, if frame buffer is not required to be null, and we're going to create the frame buffer here. Frame buffer equals frame buffer plus. So I'm going to try and make sure that it doesn't get reset. So I'm going to trace this dot frame buffer equals frame buffer. So these should be the same instance, and if they're not, I have to reapproach this. Build directory is kind of screwy, so we're going to remove that. So this should pop out a ton of trees. So this is going to do is going to it's going to save. I'm not gonna actually use the render loop, I'm actually gonna use the update loop. I'm gonna show you why. We can control our updating in a separate way. And we'll still have our frame buffer. You guys are welcome to chat. And if you want to ask any questions, I'll answer them. So close. Oh, it's because I cleared out the build director. That's why it's looking extra now. All right. Come on. Come on, one. There we go. So, oh, false is different. Interesting. I thought it was the same. It was lying to me. Okay. That's cool. Okay. It is a different instance every time. You know, but I did get this working yesterday with a single instance, so I'm going to stick with that. I'm going to try and dig into why it's a different one every time. So I'm going to stick with this. And what we're going to do, we're going to do this slightly different. We're going to get rid of this. We'll get rid of that. And we're going to see if it was already initialized. We're going to return. And then it's like initialized here. Okay. Now, we're going to instantiate our injection settings. New injection settings. Okay. And now, we're going to pass it our back buffer, our frame buffer. Now, I think that's all we'll need for the moment. There will be more. In fact, one thing I know we're going to need is our fonts, which we'll need to load. So, have that. So injection settings, we're going to need our back buffer. Better. That's going to be an image, a hot image. And our frame buffer. I may not even need this later. In fact, I know I didn't pass this in, but now we're going to create our object factory. Factory is going to be the first thing we're going to do. Our new object factory. So everything gets created through the object factory. We'll make sure we have that now. We also need to create our injector for our dependency injection. Injector. We need to make sure that our object factory injector is set. There we go. Our first thing we want our injector to know, be aware of is map value. So when we ask for a object creator, we're going to return the object factory. And I think I'm going to stop here for now and continue this for tomorrow, but I'm going to do one more thing. I've got a library here called Continuation. We're going to be using this library, Hex Continuation. It's a way of working with the callbacks, chains of callbacks, so you're not using functions that call functions that call functions. Yes, it's going to happen underneath, but we want it to be a lot clearer. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go to the call file and add a new, actually I have to add two libraries, right? I'm going to add library and inject, so that'll build. And then we're going to go to the command line, do hexlib install continuation. Continuation. I've already got installed. And so we just need to add it to a library. And what we're going to need to do is we're going to go back to our live game. And what we want to do is we want to load all of our fonts first. And that's the only thing I want to load fonts. I'm just going to pass it a function of void return. And then we're going to actually call our injection settings. And we're going to pass it in our pre-built fonts, which is going to be a map of the name and the font. Okay, so now we're going to pass in our fonts. Boom. Okay. There we go. We got our fonts being passed in. So now we need to call this function, load fonts. PRV load fonts. And this is where a little bit of this magic is going to happen. So if we look at continuation, we have to add this build metadata to it to make this happen. So I actually created a live template for it. You can just actually just copy and paste this, but I'm actually doing async, and there it is. Okay. Next, we need to add, so here you say CPS by meta. I'm using colon async. You can use anything there, so I'm going to use what they recommend, which is async. So we do the at symbol colon async. And so this is a build macro. But actually generate all the callbacks we need to make this happen. And what we're going to do is we're going to, first of all, instantiate our fonts map, string font, and then we're going to set our first key. So whenever we add more fonts, we're just going to add a new key. And all we need is just a name. We're going to go with the name. So here is that. And now we actually need to load our font. So usually when you load a font, you have to do assets, load font, you give it a name, and then you have to do this callback, and then you get a font. And this is basically going to happen under the covers for us. So I'm just showing you what it's doing. And so what we're going to end up having to do here, to simulate exactly what we're doing, we'd have to say fonts set this to our font, right? But we can clean this up way better. So if we do it this way, we can say await, which is from continuation. It's a special metadata, await. And then we pass it, we just call our function assets load font. And we don't need to pass it the callback in there. So if we added another font, just duplicate this line, change the name, font is loaded. A lot cleaner in my opinion. So now we don't have all these callback chains. So here we go. And the convenient thing is that it takes the first argument from the function and just returns it. So it actually returned our font. So to make this sort of a little bit clear, we could actually do it like this, and that's the same thing, like that, but I'm going to just do one liner just to make it cleaner. So if I want to add a new font, I just do it there. So now we're going to add our fonts in, etc., and so that cleans that up for us. I'm going to do a quick build to make sure things are still building. And we're going to run our unit tests as well. Xlib run in unit test just for good measure. Keep the CPU nice and warm. While that's building, So this is building all the MinJect stuff that we'll be using. So the MinJect stuff, what it does is, I kind of glossed over this, what MinJect will do is actually inject these graphics in for us whenever we instantiate this. It's kind of magical, but not really when you understand how the Kinesis injection works. And we actually just do it. That was part of our initial object factory, so that the injector just does it automatically, and it'll feel like we always have our dependencies ready to go for us. Looks like our game build is going to happen before our unit test build. And there we go. So game still builds. That's happy. Still have leftover nonsense in the buffer. That's normal. And so while that's building, I'm going to add our top file, get add courses, and I'm going to say loading fonts and passing to injection settings. There we go. I'd love to do more today, but unfortunately I have my day job I have to go to. But we'll continue this tomorrow, and we'll get this together, more together. I'm excited about this. I'm super excited. Subscribe to my YouTube channel. You guys can follow along. You can see how this game is going to be built. I've got a lot of good plans. I'm really excited about this. Hope you guys are enjoying this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to git push origin Skylar master so that you guys can follow along with what was built today. We're going to tag it as well. Tag with today is not February, March 7th, so 2016, 03, 07, right? Am I crazy? Yeah, I am crazy. OH43 message added display rendering objects, and then we push Skylar. This tag that'll be up in GitHub. GitHub. Live game. And here we have it. We should have our loading our fonts and that, and our tag should be here. There she is. Okay. Sorry about the technical difficulties over the last few days. Hopefully that won't happen again. And we'll continue on tomorrow, and we'll get some stuff showing up on screen again, and we'll have... It'll be great. I'm excited, and you guys have a great afternoon. Thanks.